and build outs for guys that, you know, a lot of us are the same. We always wanted to do something like this, and all of my customers are professionals that later in life have found a means to do it, and I like to fuel the passion and encourage them, which their wives may or may not like. But they come down, and you know, I try and model the business around guys that want to grow with us, you know, and grow with BGB.
Well, that's so cool. It's kind of unusual that the California guys end up in Florida.
I know.
Right?
I know.
So there's another guy, a California guy, who I spoke with just recently, Tommy Kendall, TK.
Yeah, I love TK.
Right? So
friends,
so I met him just a few weeks ago. I've known of TK for years. You know, I was involved in IMSA back in the 80s, sort of in the heydays of when he was racing as well. So it was a real cool thing to be able to meet him. But that's the only other real California guy. I had the Strattons on probably about 6 months ago, and they're California guys now. But, you know, they're into buses and Volkswagen stuff, but also tons of Porsche stuff.
Yep.
So there are some guys, but it's kind of few. So it's really cool to hear. I had no idea that you were a California guy.
And I was actually living in Manhattan Beach, where I think TK grew up. But he's, you know, you heard me say this before. He comes from an era where we had what I would call real race car drivers. And I say that because nowadays everyone wants to be a race car driver, and it's really hard to make it in this business. But he comes from a time where, you know, they threw you in the deep end, and it was either sink or swim. And he did a heck of a job becoming a phenomenal, you know, Trans Am driver. And he, you know, does less driving now and more is of an on-air personality. But much like you, myself, and everybody else here, he's a car guy. And I think that's the common thread with all these guys is we all grew up loving things on four wheels that make strange smells and odd noises, and it's a passion for a lot of us.
That's funny, the odd noise thing. Yeah. You know, they're odd, but sometimes they're familiar. So about 3 weeks ago, I had the privilege of going to an event with the dealership, with Porsche South Orlando, that we did with another racer from California.
Okay.
You know, with the racers group.
Okay.
You know who I'm talking about.
Kevin Buckler,
yeah, right? Yeah, yeah. So he threw this really cool event, and we participated in it. We brought some cars out to support it. He was introducing a new line of wines from Adobe Road.
Yes.
Some awesome wines, and the amount of time and effort that they put into developing this line of wines, just from a winemaker standpoint, was fantastic. But the amount of effort that they put in to tie motorsports into the branding of the wines, it was just off the charts.
Nope.
And it's just so cool to see that. So I'll finish up my story, and I'll let you finish up your thought, because something just came into your mind.
Yep. You can table it first.
I drove a GT3 RS out to the event.
Okay.
And right out of that,
where was the event?
It was out at the Waldorf Astoria here near Disney.
Yep.
And he put on an awesome event. And I got out of that GT3 RS into my 1989 911 Targa 3.2.
Yep.
And I thought to myself,
is this thing broken?
What's going to happen? You know, what's going to be my, what am I going to feel like? Am I going to, you know? But you know, the thing was, I wasn't disappointed at all, because there was a linkage to it. And like the gearbox sound was kind of the same. The rawness of the two cars was kind of the same. So it was like, this is totally cool. I wasn't disappointed at all. I'm like, this is what Porsche is all about. It's about the connections that they constantly bring from their racing history and heritage all the way current to modern technology. And I just thought, you know, it was such a cool experience to be able to do that, you know, to go. So what was your thought?
Well, my thought was that Kevin does a phenomenal job at marketing the Porsche passion with whatever product relationship he's trying to cultivate. And actually, he's somebody that over the years, from that perspective, I've tried to emulate. But let's talk more about your story about getting into a car that's 40 years older than...
Well, whatever. I'm not good at math.
It's okay. Neither. I don't math. The RS is an amazing piece of technology, and how those cars have evolved over the year is pretty phenomenal. But at the same time, you cannot replicate that visceral experience that you get only from an older Porsche. No ABS, no PSM, no sound deadening material, no cup holders, no ventilated seats, no creature comforts, and it still smells like your childhood. I'm sure every time, and that it makes that strange sound when you open the door that only a Porsche does. And I don't think you can replicate that with a lot of other cars, because with most cars, you're so happy to be in the newer iteration of it. Whereas with the Porsche, you find yourself like appreciating that older vintage.
Yeah, I mean, it goes, you know, full spectrum. It goes both ways, you know, to bringing out the heritage, bringing out those, like you said, you sort of get those feelings from your childhood, whatever. Yeah, the car still, you know, it's got that very distinctive smell inside.
Yep.
And all the noises, and it's, you know, it's just really cool to be able to experience that and share that with folks. And I just thought, you know, what an experience to be able to do that. And on a night, on top of all the cool stuff that we did with Kevin and his group, it was just kind of icing on the cake, you know, all together. So, all right. So when you said that in 2005, you got together with your business partner, who the guy you took to Pocono.
He took me.
Oh, he took you. Right. He took you along.
And I was the analyst, and it was like, hey, you know, you come and be my grunt and check my tire pressures, and I'll let you turn some laps. And, you know, like I said, my experience is no different than everybody and than anybody else's. You get on a racetrack, you're like, oh, this is something I've always wanted to do. I remember coming home telling my dad, hey, I'm going to, you know, blow off a finance career to become a business owner and run a motorsport business. And I think he about fell out of his chair. But we've been lucky enough to, you know, make some cool projects come together. And we had a very, you know, because of the support of my partner, we had a very successful racing history, which allowed me to build a brand out of BGB. And it gives you this credibility. So now a lot of guys have come to us, you know, they're like, hey, you raced a Cayman in the 24 Hours of Daytona with a 911 engine. And, you know, they all knew the story of this car that we slapped together in the shop in like 20 days and made it last for 24 hours. And it basically blossomed into, you know, us, we've lost count as to how many 911 engines we shoved in Caymans and Boxsters. And it turns into an arms race. Now it's 4 liters and bigger than 4 liters, and you're always trying to stay ahead of the curve. But the cool thing is that we try and do a little bit of something for everyone, whether it's you know, putting a manual transmission in a GT3 RS, which we got a lot of press out of a year or two ago because I was the only one dumb enough to sign up for that project, and I believe it's the only one like it in the world. And then back at the shop, I'm trying to do it again. You know, I left the shop this afternoon. We're putting PDK in a GT4 road car. And it doesn't exist because there are a lot of guys in racing that have injuries that can't drive a manual and have a want for PDK. And we've built a lot of PDK race cars. So it's just a question of trying to always figure out what the market wants.
Yeah.
And I'm happy to be able to, you know, bring things to fruition that, you know, that the market wants.
Well, I mean, it's awesome that you've gathered all this experience, you know, technical experience, experience at the track, experience in just dealing with guys who want to do some crazy things sometimes. And that's not real easy, right? Because they have expectations.
They do.
And you're trying to be realistic with them to say, hey, you know, we can do this. It's going to be a journey. I'm going to tell you, it, you know, you got to be ready for the ups and downs, right?
I am. And I always forewarn them. I'm like, look, this is a very slippery slope. And there's a good chance your wife or your kids are going to hate me because you're going to be gone all the time. And you're going to be at the racetrack with this new love of yours. But, you know, life lasts a long time, and your reputation is all that you have in this industry. So I have, you know, it might be taking me longer to get where I want to be, but I've always, you know, erred on the side of being conservative and trying to make customers last a long time, because, you know, there are other shops that try and turn these guys out. And I need guys to be around for a long time, because my business is modeled around their being here and bringing cars to us year after year after year. And luckily, I live, you know, 70 minutes from one of the biggest Porsche markets in the country. You know, you'd never think, but Orlando is actually a very big Porsche market. I know we're in the top 10. I don't know if we're the top 6 or 7, but there are a lot of Porsche owners, and there are a lot of guys that go to Sebring and Daytona and Homestead, and when you live in Paradise and it's warm 12 months a year, you can take your car to the racetrack, whereas everybody north of the Mason-Dixon line is buried under snow for 4 or 5 months a year. So this is a good place to be when you're trying to build a business like this. And we're very fortunate to have a lot of great customers that give us good referrals. I try, you know, the best thing that I would do is you go to the track, find two buddies that like to compete, and you're like, oh, I'm going to make your car faster. And then the guy pulls me aside and like, here, you know, give me a little bit of give me some extra sauce to keep him honest. So, you know, we have a good time with it.
Yeah, it's all good in competition, right? A lot of, I mean, when you live in Central Florida, it's almost you take for granted some of this stuff, you know, that people literally will travel from around the other side of the world to come in March to go to the 12 Hours of Sebring just to experience, you know, one of the top three endurance racing events in the world. And people who live here in Central Florida who aren't crazy car guys like you and me or Porsche guys or whatever you want to call it, they don't understand that. They don't get just how strong a thing that is in that racing community in endurance racing, that this is a mecca. I mean, it's unbelievable that within the span of a couple of hours, really, or 2.5 hours, I guess, maybe between Sebring and Daytona, you have two of the three top races in the world here every year. And you have two tracks that are just, you know, prolific in a sense that, you know, when you live here and you participate in the community, whether it be with PCA or with guys like you or guys like maybe like Chin Motorsports or, you know, all these different groups, you get to drive on these tracks and experience all this stuff right close by, which is, you know, pretty awesome experience.
No, I had one of those moments. Like, those that know us and follow our social media at BGB Motorsports Group on Instagram and our Facebook page know that I'm a little bit click happy with the camera. And you know, a couple weeks ago, I was very fortunate. I have a couple customers that started with me, and I took them PCA club racing, and they've grown up into IMSA. And one of my customers, Tom Collingwood, was one of the first people to buy one of the new GT4 Club Sport race cars. And I was, you know, very lucky to fulfill a lifelong dream. I got to drive with Tom in the four-hour race the day before the 24-hour. And then 48 hours later, we had the car turned around, and I was headed to Sebring. And I left my house at 5 a.m. to drive down there like I normally do. And I drove by the speedway, and it was all lit up. And I had one of those moments where I'm like, this is really cool. Like, I'm going to drive, you know, 3 hours, and I'm going to go from the center of one of the biggest sports car races in the world. And then I'm going to get to go down to Sebring and test. And then I'm going to get to drive, you know, with my customer the day before the 12-hour. And, you know, there are a lot of guys that have been doing this for a long time. And they may get used to it after a while, but when you drive in these races and you look around and you're like, oh my goodness, there are fans. Yeah. Like, there are people out there, like, watching this stuff. Yeah. Like, you have these kind of really cool moments where you're like, you know, there were many nights that I didn't think that we'd get here. And it's cool. And you're right. Like, you're lucky when you live in Florida, you get to live within 3 hours of two of the biggest sports car races in the world. And I think we're kind of spoiled down here.
Yeah, you know, and that California connection, right? Florida and California are, you know, arguably the two biggest markets maybe in the United States for Porsche, or at least with, you know, how crazy people are. I mean, there's other markets around that are strong too, but just think of those because of the linkage with the tracks, because of all the California car culture, because of, you know, places like Laguna Seca, you know, and all this kind of stuff that are just, you know, kind of crazy out there experiences for people. Everybody wants to go to Laguna Seca. If you're a sports car guy, that's on your list. Everybody wants to either drive on the corkscrew or, you know, be in the stands and watch cars drop down into the corkscrew and run around that place. So it's cool that Florida guys, you know, we get to puff out our chest a little bit with the California guys, because they can't say that they got the 24 hours of Daytona and Sebring in their backyard.
No, they can't. And you know, I have to tell you, I only got to live out there for a couple of years. I'm originally from Philadelphia. And when I was just getting into this, it was, you know, January in the Northeast, and I had to go get a competition license in 2001. So I signed up because I was like, Laguna Seca, you know, like everybody else, I played it on Gran Turismo. It looks really cool. I want to go out there. And that's where I went, and I got my competition license. But I don't know what the stat is, but there has to be, you know, there has to be more Porsche passion in Southern California than like most places around the world. And if the attendance at Rennsport Union is any indication of that, like, that is a massive market. And you do have that, you've got that heritage. I mean, God rest his soul, that's where James Dean, you know, he lost his life. He was driving on a Friday afternoon from Los Angeles to go to Laguna Seca to race his 550. There's a lot of Porsche passion and heritage in Southern California. Man. That's where Porsche Motorsports based. And they, you know, they've had Rennsport Union at Lime Rock, they've had it at Daytona. But I think with the amount of turnout that you get in California, I think it's going to stay out there for a while.
Oh, yeah. No, it's absolutely the right place. I'll argue that they need to bring it to Daytona, you know, every now and again.
Once in 10 years.
Yeah, maybe more often than that. But at least, you know, give the East Coast a chance. But that is just, I mean, you can't. What's a better place than Monterey Peninsula, Laguna Seca? It's just, you know, it's magic. It's an unbelievable area. And that's where people want to go.
Yep.
So.
The weather.
Yeah, the weather is a little bit a little bit better. You never know here, no. You know, in the months that they typically do it, sometimes it can be a little off here. All right, so maybe switch gears a little bit. We're talking about all that kind of stuff, but maybe we go right into this particular car that you brought out here.
Our latest project. So 2017 was kind of a transition period for Porsche. I believe, and somebody might correct me, I could be wrong, but there are really only two models of naturally aspirated Porsches left that you can buy. You can either buy a GT3 or a GT4. And those have naturally aspirated non-turbocharged engines, and I hope to see that they stay that way for a long time. I don't know if that's going to be the case. However, every Carrera, 911 Carrera that is built after 2017 is now a turbocharged car. It's the same engine in all three models, whether it's the base, the S, or the GTS. And, you know, while my dad warns me that, you know, be careful, you know, a lot of pioneers were found, you know, dead. I like to try and be a pioneer with the things that we do in the shop. So I went out and bought this car from Porsche Melbourne and developed a bunch of products for it for the racetrack because, you know, there are guys that love the GT3 for the track, but I think that there are a lot of guys who have some other higher powers to answer to that need, you know, two seats in the back to be able to bring the kids, you know, to and from the local convenience store. So I wanted to build this car and show that you could take a standard 911 Carrera and show that, you know, with turbocharging, there's plenty of torque and horsepower on tap for this car to go to a racetrack and, you know, stop the senseless bullying that I see from GT3 owners. Like, I've become, you know, known among the Cayman circles, and the Cayman is slowly beginning to get the horsepower that it deserves, but the GT3 still does reign supreme at the racetrack. And those that know me know that I like to try and puff up the underdog a little bit to try and get him to that next step. And this car is no different. It has a bunch of suspension mods, all monoball suspension that you'd find on a cup car, and but very light power mods, because for about $5,000 or $6,000, we could get this thing up into the 600 horsepower range, which you can't do with a naturally aspirated car. And with my partners from Cobb Tuning that have helped me along the way, I've developed a lot of ECU flashes for the Macans, and now I'm trying to do it with the turbocharged Carreras.
Wow, so that's pretty exciting stuff. Pretty cool stuff indeed. So what's the horsepower on this one?
On the dyno, and everything goes to the dyno, because I need to back up. You know, I don't make claims, and when I do, they're very conservative. But on the dyno, it makes over 500 horsepower, but more importantly, it makes over 500 pound-foot of torque. And torque is the measure of acceleration, and I've spent a lot of years tuning naturally aspirated Porsches and getting, you know, Porsches make great horsepower, but getting torque out of a flat six is trying to, like, squeeze blood from a stone. And with these cars, you know, I, like, about fell out of the seat when I saw the gains that we make from, you know, just an exhaust and a flash, you know, over 100 horsepower and over 100 pound-foot at the tires just from an ECU flash and an exhaust upgrade. Whereas on a naturally aspirated car, those numbers would be about 15 to 20.
Yeah. So you're getting a lot of bang for your buck. If you want to get into really modifying your car and doing your own thing and sort of operating outside of the Porsche.
The road less traveled.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's awesome. So what's the next big project for you? Is there something that's coming down the road that's even more exciting? I guess there always is. I mean, that's what you're thinking about, right?
Back at the shop, I'm always trying to find other projects that, you know, will incite people to send us their cars. And we've been very lucky because of this pedigree. I have guys that will send me, you know, cars from all over the country that I've never even met before because they know that we're a trusted name in the industry. So we've got some 4 liters in the shop. We've got things that are even bigger than 4 liter that we're building right now. Transmission swaps, but I'm hopeful a lot of GT4 owners that once these cars come out of warranty to go to the track, I want them to send us their cars for more of the safety upgrades. Like the GT4 out of the box, it has the aero, it has the brakes, it has the suspension, the power's there, but some of these guys are going around places like Sebring and Daytona, you know, doing lap times that 10 years ago would have put you on the front row for the 12 hours of Sebring in the lowest GT class, and they need safety upgrades. And you know, like I said, I need them to be around for a long time. So we're doing a lot of race car builds of newer generation cars, and then we're doing a lot of service work. There, you know, where we are in Ormond Beach, you're about 2 hours from any Porsche dealership, or an hour and a half, and I'm in this kind of triangle where there's this dearth of a Porsche dealership. So we're trying to do anything we can to stay busy. Yeah. And if I'm not, you know, building something cool, I have no problem welcoming a guy in with a 2002 Boxster, you know, that has a leaky coolant tank or something like that. Because, you know, where we are in Ormond Beach, we don't have a lot of Porsche owners. So I tell people, I don't turn anyone away. You know, we may not have an elaborate facility such as you with your nice new dealership, but maybe I could get a Keurig fired up in the lounge area at the shop.
Yeah, that's it. You got to feed them. Yep. You got to feed them. You got to give them a drink.
And
coffee.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. So how many guys on your staff? How many people work at BGB Motorsports?
I have
3 guys in the shop full time, and then a guy in the office with me to help handle a lot of the retail movement, selling stuff on the internet. And then when we go to the track with 4 or 5 customers, I have guys that fly in. Like a lot of folks don't know that a lot of my weekend fly-in guys are guys that dedicate their vacation and their free time. They have full-time jobs, but they love to come to the track and help out. So it's a 3 or 4 day weekend. They get to see their old buddies, but you know, I would be lost without the support of my people in the shop. And then the support of my guys that when I call them up, I'm like, hey, I got an extra guy. He wants to go to Homestead. We got to go down there with another car. Can you do it? And they're like, yeah, I'll be there. Just tell me when to be there and when. And, you know, without that kind of commitment, we wouldn't be where we are.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome, dude, because those are the guys who, you know, it's in here.
Yes.
They want to do it because they just got a passion for doing it. If they get paid or if they get consideration otherwise, that's just like icing on the cake. They don't really think about that a whole lot. Maybe your guys do, I don't know, but you know what I'm saying.
It's a passion.
Yeah, it's a passion, and that's what, you know, makes it all the more special for them, just to know that, hey, they can participate.
Yep.
And they can break away from the normal routine and stay involved.
I mean, it's almost like a working vacation for them. It's some of them live in places that there's a foot of snow on the ground, and they're like, hey, are we going to Sebring? Because I looked at the weather and it's 80 and sunny for the next 4 days. Like, you know, what do you need? And, you know, we have a good time. Like, I have spent years trying to build the right group of people, because, you know, a lot of people have a pretty phenomenal resume. They have a lot of accomplishments. But what I need is...
We got somebody over here who's... They're having some fun, huh?
Three guys. Anyway, no, you know, I have always tried to find the right group of people, because I've said, look, I don't care what you've done. I don't care how smart you are. But what I need is I need people that work well together. And we've had instances where we've been stuck at the track till 2 and 3 in the morning. And I've been there and I just kind of smile, because there are my guys joking and cracking. And, you know, the radio's on and they're having a good time. And most people would have like kind of a sour look on their face because they're stuck at the track till 3 in the morning. But these guys, they have the bug. And it's kind of like you saying, like, I heard this in a movie somewhere, I don't know who said it, but, you know, you can't put it in them and you can't take it out of them. You know, you either have it or you don't.
Yeah.
And if you don't have it, and if it's not a pleasure to be there, you know, we don't really want you coming to the track with us.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. Well, I can't thank you enough for coming in.
Thank
now,
you.
I know that before we got started, Ryan was here. Is he still here? Is he still?
Is he still
around?
Ryan Dion.
I don't know. Is he still around? We lost him, maybe. Well, we'll see if he's, I don't know if he's still here, but maybe you can track him down and we can bring him back for a few minutes afterwards. But
if I had some haggis, he probably
Well, again, you know, just want to thank you for coming in. I know the first time we tried to take a stab at this, it was just it was a long weekend for you at the track and then
all that kind of stuff.
Totally get it.
And I'm just glad we're able to work it out this time and have you in to do this.
No, it's a real honor to be here. And like I said, if you're in the Central Florida area and you want a new Porsche or a used Porsche, you go see Brian at Porsche South Orlando, because it is supposedly the coolest dealership in the country.
Well, it is a cool place. It's a shameless plug, but I'll take it.
I'll take it. I'll take it every day, all day.
I like to give it words, too.
All right, cool. Well, thanks, John, for coming on. We really appreciate it. And I think now we're going to have a little piece that's going to show you a little bit about what John's talking about with Porsche South Orlando. And a little fun we had out there with the Porsche Club. Going back, I don't know, a month or so ago, we had a special time on a Sunday morning before we opened. We had a Cars and Coffee event. So this is a little bit of a view into what we did out there that day. So